Kane is in the building.
She says I'm a scumbag, wants to take her love back. Story of my life, my such an asshole. Everything is my fault, happens every time.
Alright boys, if you didn't get to that last clip, I am now the Tully. 2020 has been a weird year. We had, you know, coronavirus, the COVIDs, new president, Kobe Bryant passed away, rest in peace, and Scott Mellon's now the Tully. It's just some things we never thought would ever happen, finally happened, you know, and it's kind of like the show, The Undercover Boss. I kind of wanted to do that this year with you guys. You know, I've been watching the show and I feel like giving back, so I want to see what it looks like to be in your shoes, like you peasants, like how you view fantasy football. And I must say it does not feel good, so I don't think I'll be doing that again. So this should be the only time I'm in last place, but I'll fetch you guys beers, I'll do whatever you want. I do deserve that, so hopefully next year's better. My team sucked. Took too many chances. None of those chances paid off, but is what it is. But let's get to the finals. It is now Chris Tully, his first finals appearance ever, and Dickie LaFlemme, either his second or third, maybe fourth, actually, I forget. But so those two, they won last week. Dickie beat Scott Cobley, a very high-scoring matchup, and Chris Tully beat Steve Burke in, I think, a two-point matchup. So I'm going to spin this off. We'll go right to Tom Penny, because he was the Tully last year. He was able to give me the Tully trophy, which is now broken because I try to hang it from my podcast microphone, so I got to fix that. So Tom, like, how does it feel to get rid of the Tully? I know it was stewing in your downstairs bathroom for a full year, so it's probably good to get that out of there. Also, do you think COVID affected the NFL and fantasy this year? And what are your thoughts on the whole keeper situation? Because now we don't have keepers going forward. And who do you think will win this matchup?
All right, Antoine Walker. So I got my question from Scotty. How's it feel to get rid of the Tully? It feels fucking awesome to get rid of the Tully. I'm so glad I'm not going to be fetching you guys fucking beers again. That sucked. Actually, not even really fetching the beers, honestly. It was just being in last place, coming off of a championship, which sucked. Luckily, Tyler and Burke's team absolutely shit the bed at the end of the season, because I thought it was a wrap in week 9 when Scotty had a week up on me, but made some key pickups or whatever and got myself out of that. His next question is about COVID, how I thought it impacted the year. I mean, obviously it had an impact, but I don't think it had an impact where it would have dramatically changed the outcome of where we are today. I mean, my team would have sucked with or without COVID. You know, Scotty's team would have sucked with or without COVID. So it is what it is. It was another playing element that we had to come up over. I mean, I thought we implemented a pretty good rule of, you know, picking a backup and manually changing it, you know, if something happened. But luckily, like, the NFL was transparent with everybody. We knew what games were potentially at risk. They were pushing them back, what players were potentially at risk. So it really wasn't any different than the questionable tag, in my opinion. Third one was about, you know, keepers. Keepers make our league, right? That's what makes the league special, is keepers. And now that we don't have keepers, you know, the league's a sham. You know, it's bullshit. I think it sucks. I think our league's, and I'm just fucking with everybody. 15 years we've been playing together. Everybody goes away once a weekend. We have a great fucking time this year. We can all, you know, hound Scotty to get us beers. It's great. I mean, that's our league. So if you think it's keepers, you can go fuck yourself. And then last but not least, the championship. I'm rooting for Tull. 100% rooting for Tull. I don't know how you can't root for Tull, to be completely honest. I mean, he's a fucking Cinderella story. It took him 9 years. Comes in last place 4 years in a row. Knocking on the door the next four. And bada bing, bada boom, he's in the fucking playoffs. So Tully, coach your guys up. Give him a pep talk and go beat the fuck out of Dickie. I don't want to see your name on that trophy again, Dickie. Go fuck yourself. But seriously, Dickie, Tully, good luck. See you guys 2021 with no fucking keepers.
Right, thanks, Tom. I'll keep that Tully warm in my basement for the next year. And, yeah, I mean, this league, if there's no keepers, I don't know what makes this a league. So, we'll see if we can change that. Probably not ever again, but I'm going to shoot this over to Tyler. Tyler missed the playoffs by one game. I think he had the same record or maybe one less win, but he didn't have a lot of points. But what do you think you could have changed to get there? Any moves, any decisions that would have, you know, factored in you getting that fourth seed over Cobbs and Burke? And did you play the weekly matchups right, like Dickie said? Because that's the only way to play fantasy. And what is your thought on the new Tully, which is me?
Hey, Scotty. Just checking in for fantasy. I've got three things I want to talk about. Number one, I didn't even realize I missed the playoffs. I thought we had another week until playoff seedings were, like, finalized. Definitely disappointing. You know, not that surprising. I probably haven't watched a football game in, like, 3 weeks. But, you know, I'll get them next year. I was, you know, I seem to draft pretty well, so we'll see what happens. Number two, we can't let Dickie win. It's so frustrating watching the group chat and seeing him not understand what we talk about when we talk about these matchups. Dickie's had a great team, of course. He probably would have made the playoffs anyway. But to not even admit that there's a significant amount of luck with how your matchups end up is so infuriating. And I hate you, Dickie. All right, number three. Scotty, you're Hitler. You controlled George's team for the entire season. You screwed me over. You screwed everyone over. And worst of all, you screwed yourself over. You deserve last place. You deserve to get everybody beers on the camping trip. And you, yeah, you just kind of suck. All right. That's Tyler checking in. I'll see you later.
All right. Once again, I did not control George's team, but apparently everyone thinks that. So I am the Hitler, and I think it affected me more than anyone else this year. Still haven't talked to George about it yet, but I did help him all year, and he missed the playoffs. But yeah, so my next question is to Baldy. And Baldy, you had the hardest schedule. You won the unlucky award. You had the most points against, and I think top three in points scored. So how do you think, like, you could have done better, which I don't think you could have. I think you put out the best team each week. You scored a load of points. You had a very tough schedule. But how can we, you know, how could you change that as in fantasy to take that luck kind of out of it? Is there a way to do that? And again, who do you think's gonna win? Tully or Dickie? All right, yeah, Baldy, to you.
Okay, thanks, Scotty. Listen, I want to give a quick congratulations to the boys, Dickie and Tully. You guys made the finals. Congratulations. Even though your schedules were the easiest things I've ever seen in my life. I mean, shit, I had some of the worst weeks I've ever had. And with your schedules, I would have won those games. And I likely would have been like 9-5, 10-4 in the playoffs. It's fantasy, though. It happens. Week-to-week league, right, Dickie? Listen, there's a lot of luck in this game. But I don't know what we can do to fix it. I just think it's just one of those things where when you're getting lucky, you fucking brag about it. And when you're not, you get pissed about it. I've been on the Tully side before where I score like no points, sneak into the playoffs because I got nothing against me. It happens. Just sucks when you get third most points, you lose your fucking best player on the goddamn team, and you still finish with third most points, and you get 1,000,001 points against you on the goddamn season. You even go into the freaking consolation game, and you get 165 points dropped on you. It's not my year. But that's okay. I don't want it to be either of these fucking guys' years in the finals, though. My God. Dickie. The biggest complainer in the world for someone who's won the league. Your team put up points, dude. You had a good season. Just face it. You had nobody scored against you. And you too, Tully, including the playoffs, you lucky prick. I'm sure it'll be your season. I'm sure Dickie will put up like 114 points. You'll put up probably 119.5, and you'll win the goddamn championship, and it's a goddamn cluster F. But that's okay. It's a week-to-week league, boys. Better luck next year. We'll see you in Raymond. I'll make sure my round goes quite long, so you guys are all fucked up. Preferably Scotty. Congratulations on the Tully, you little bitch.
All right. Thanks, Baldy, on that. As I sit here drinking my Irish coffee, top shelf fancy glass, I'm still waiting on a few packages. I hope they arrive today. It's Christmas Eve, and we got a lot of top shelf merchandise coming in, but apparently I kind of know why they're delayed, and it's because of Burke. Burke has paused his UPS route and has decided to answer the following questions. He made the playoffs again, but lost in the first round. What could he have done to change it to be in the finals? And how do you think COVID affected the fantasy season as a whole? And again, who do you think will win, Tully or Dickie? Cheers, Burke.
All right, out here with my helper, Jose Berrios, cousin of MLB pitcher, Jose Berrios. We're going to take a little quick video. We're a little busy this time of the year, but the question was, how has COVID affect the season? I don't think it affected it too much, besides a little unnecessary anxiety, and but it didn't really have much of an impact on the season at all. What do you think?
No impact at all.
No impact. All right. What could I have changed? I would have given Todd Gurley a new knee. I think that would have helped my season. And who do I think is going to win the finals? I would say Dickie probably has the best team in the league from at least the last half, for sure. Tully's been getting real fortunate, even with his injuries last week, still pulled out a win. So he might have some more magic left in him this week. I'm not sure, but I think Dickie's got it. All right, Merry Christmas, all.
All right, thank you, Berkey, and thanks, Berkey's helper. Pretty cool. Related to a pitcher in MLB. Good for you. And I'm asking Scott a question. So I was not able to actually send a video back. He's been busy, but he was nice enough to actually send a detailed answer. So I'll read that. Again, Scott lost to Dickie in the first round. He scored 160 points. Dickie scored, I think, 170, 175. So it was very high scoring, very close, but he did lose. Kind of anything he could have changed to be in the finals instead of losing. But again, what else would I ask? Yeah, pretty much that. What could he have done different to make a bigger push? He went and said he had a good year, he thinks, considering CMC went down. Fournette was released after the draft, and Carson was banged up throughout the entire season. The thing he would have changed is the trade he did with Stryker. He was looking forward to the playoffs and thought pairing Aaron Jones and CMC would get me the shit. Unfortunately, CMC didn't come back, and Aaron Jones had a good playoff game, but that trade cost me matchups in the regular season, which made me get the fourth seed. So that's a huge thing. If you didn't do the trade, you might have had the third seed or second seed, and you would have easily beat Tully or Burke. So that is a big, seeding's a big thing, because he should be in the finals now against Dickie. But he's not, and he said for the championship, it would be cool to see Tully win for the first time, but I think Dickie should win. He has the best team. So All right, Chips, thank you very much, and have a Merry Christmas. Yeah, go to who's up next. I think that might be it, but if not, I'll let you know. All right, another one that couldn't send a video. He's too busy plumbing. So I just asked him kind of, this is Stryker. He's a plumber, so he won the most points, and this is the first time ever that most points did not make the playoffs. I don't know how it happened, but again, it was kind of like Baldy. He had a tough schedule. He put up a buttload of points, and he couldn't win. So I think I asked if he could change anything with that, which I don't think he could have. I think he put out the best lineup, put out the best team because he had the most points, and that trade with Chibs probably helped him more than it helped Chibs. He did say, just make one for me, which I'm doing. He thinks Dickie will win by a landslide, but since he hates Dickie, he wants Tully to win. And if I had any of the top four team schedules this year, he would be in first and won the championship. Yeah, I'd like to go in and see that, because I know Dickie had a lot of points too, so... yeah, probably if you had any of their schedules, especially, I think, Tully had an easy one, but I think you would have easily made the playoffs, so... I feel for you, Stryker, and he kept on saying, beer me, beer me, beer me, and payback's a bitch. I don't know what that means. I was always very nice to Stryker the 3 years that I forced him to go out in a canoe to get me beer, so I don't know what he's talking about. He's pretty surprised he's joshing. All right, Stryker, thank you very much, and I think that concludes all the interviews. So, let's get to the championship. Dickie versus Tully. I was able to get an interview with them the other day, so I'll do a little intro and then you'll see the interview. So, congrats, guys. Well deserved. Antoine Walker Fantasy Football League of Champions. We got Tully here with no shorts on. We have Dickie here with only a shirt on. And these are the two finalists for Antoine Walker. Congrats, boys.
Thank you.
Thank you, Scotty. Thank you.
Here's up a clap.
It's been a long time coming.
Yeah, so this is Tully's third year in the playoffs. And it didn't look good after Thursday or Saturday for you. Losing Derek Carr with 1.7 points.
I think I was texting. I was like texting you, Scotty. I was like, I actually genuinely feel bad for this.
Oh yeah, because I'm like, it happens. I feel every year. It's either a Keenan Allen thing or a Julio thing or some player that Tully has in the playoffs that just gets hurt the first play or is a decoy.
Well, and what sucked for me even more is that all season, you know. Call it, you know, downplay it like Baldy all you will, but all season I'd gone undefeated for like 9-10 weeks, and then all of a sudden 11-12, 13-14, my team just shit the bed, and then that happens on Thursday and Saturday. I'm like, here we fucking go again.
I think your microphone's rubbing against your chest hairs.
It makes it way.
I think you're right.
Way better though.
It's authentic, yeah. Man.
I'm here for you.
It's homegrown.
It's a true Tully experience.
But I mean, you lost Carr. Julio was questionable, but he was still, you know, he's still a guy you were playing. He was out, I think, Saturday. Keenan Allen was tough because, like, you wish he sat because you still have to start him. If he's on the field, like, I was in a league where I had to start him. So it's like, yeah. And he ended up being used as a decoy more. I think he got like 2.9 points.
Well, and the thing is, yeah, like 2.9 or 2.1.
Yeah,
I think
two catches, I think, and that's it.
Well, and the worst part is like nothing cropped up that he was like thinking about sitting until like Friday afternoon. So I'm sitting there and I'm like, shit, do I go pick up, you know, Tyron Johnson, or do I go pick up somebody, re-pick up Sammy Watkins? I don't want to do that, but you know, I'm like,
week one Sammy.
Well, what about
week one Sammy?
Yeah, how he was yelling at the beat reporter saying, play me. He's like, don't sit me.
Yeah. And then he comes out and he puts up that joke, like, and like stops playing after the third series. Like,
well, he
fuck
came
you, bro.
Out of the tunnel. Him and Mike Williams were both like game time. They came out of the tunnel, and Keenan Allen goes to the camera. And he's like, to the camera, don't sit me. He's like, I'm about to go off, and he's like, two catches for like 13 yards.
He pulls a reverse Josh Jacobs. He's like, you know, Josh Jacobs pulls the, oh, sorry guys, I'm out.
Right.
It's like, so it's just like, yeah, but it's so frustrating because it's like, I didn't even know that there was a possibility he'd be out until like Friday afternoon. And then I'm like, no, you know what? I think, you know, It's coach speak. You know, Keenan's Keenan. He's going to go out there. And then he puts up that. And I literally texted Burke. I'm like, I have no confidence that I'm winning this matchup right now.
Yeah, he does that.
Burke had all the confidence in the world.
Yeah. I mean, and Keenan Allen's a guy where it's like, you ride or die with this guy. Like, you go down with him. You can't – he's a guy you can't even be like, all right, he's questionable. I might sit the guy. He's a top 10.
Right.
Receiver, so.
Right, because then, you know, I sit him because, oh, he's going to be on a snap count, and then he goes out, and it is coach speak, and he puts up 25, and I'm like, oh, well, sitting on my bench like fucking J.D. McKissick and Leonard Fournette, and I'm like.
You fucking crushed it, though. Yeah, but hey, you got here finally. It took you 3 years in a row in the playoffs. Dickie. Did you make it two years ago?
No. I bought our house 2 years ago. I was a champion, I think, 2 or 3 years ago, because I had the trophy when I moved into my place, and that was, it's coming up on 3 years.
Yeah. So you used the $400 for a deposit on your house.
Yeah, exactly. Yep, sure did. Yep.
Yeah. So
$400 goes a long way, man.
It does. Yeah, it does. All right. Yeah, so you beat Chibs. Chibs put up a bunch of points, so I do feel bad. Like, he would beat Tully, but again, you play the weekly matchup.
It's a weekly matchup, man.
Hey. I mean, it all depends about the seeding.
Hey, it all depends on who you're facing week to week and how you're going to face them, all right? You can't just come out there and just say, hey, I deserve this win. No, you got to fight. You got to do it weekly.
Right. All right, so I'll get into my first question. Draft strategy. I'll go to Dickie first, since he was just talking, and I can see him now. So – Did you have a draft strategy? And if not, what was your plan while drafting, especially, you know, drafting Burrow, then going down and drafting all those rookies?
So I had, what was it? I had Terry as a keeper, which I knew was going to be amazing, but I knew it was kind of like he was like the fifth to sixth round pick, because like of like all like the drafts and stuff like that I had done. So I just knew he was actually going to be really well too. So I are really good. So I like majority of the time I went after QBs. I was going after Pat Mahomes. Like, I wasn't not going to have him again. So I really went after
was
him
he hard. First round?
Uh-huh. Yeah. Okay. Yeah. I took him. And then I believe I went very heavy on running backs, actually. I don't even remember exactly the – oh, there we go.
I mean, you got Josh Jacobs, right?
Yep. I had Josh Jacobs. That's what it was. I had Josh Jacobs in the second round. Okay, now I see it here. Yeah, I had Josh Jacobs in the second round. And then I had done a bunch of mocks, and I knew with our league, like, QB is so heavy that I decided I actually, like – when it, I think it came with Travis Kelce. I'm like, you know what? It was kind of that, like, tiered approach. So I think realistically, like, I wanted Pat Mahomes. I knew I was getting Josh Jacobs, and then I really kind of went with, like, the, you know, the tiered approach. And with Kelce and the Mahomes hookup, I'm like, man, that's just awesome. And I really feel like when you just have that elite tight end, it's like everything else in your lineup can just kind of flow. And then
I mean, Kelsey's a fucking cheat code as it is. Like, he is far and away above every other tight end, even Waller, Andrews – Like he's a wide receiver that's designated for fantasy as a tight end. Like when you're talking output.
Yeah, and the guy doesn't miss games. He's insane. But I mean, yeah. I'll kind of make it short. But like the latter part is, I was really, I think it was probably the time that I was, well, like we did some dynasty and stuff like that. So I was really high on a lot of rookies. So I mean, I went after AJ Brown. I went after Jonathan Taylor, Swift. Kind of funny too. Like I know we joke about like the keeper stuff, which I'm still, you know, hopefully we get back. But like I probably drafted the most amount of rookies I've ever drafted in this draft, and it ended up paying off. I mean, Joe Burrow, I was really happy to get him 9th round. So yeah, it was just kind of a tiered approach and kind of going down that. And I think I hit it kind of, I don't know, I wouldn't say lucky with some of the guys, but like they came on at opportune times.
Well, definitely, yeah. Swift came on later. There was a split backfield there. Mm-hmm. Then he hit after what, week 7 or 8? I know he had, then he missed what, like week 10 and 11, which kind of sucked.
Yeah. But I did kind of begrudge, like, in my stubborn.
JT didn't come on until like week 10.
But I still would start them. I started JT, I started Swift. I pretty much started all those guys from the start just because I was stubborn and I was like, they're going to go off one of these weeks. And I felt confident in that. And
well, you don't want to be sitting them, then it's, that's the week. Yep. You know, yep. Yeah. So, yeah, that makes sense. And Tully, draft strategy? Or you just like, no. Or do you go into it just kind of like seeing where the draft, like how it's going, and then build off that?
So when I got into the draft, so this was my first year not having any keepers, which was a downside for me because typically I do go into the season with some fairly decent keepers, but in contrast, I felt like it kept me open to do different things. Like I knew when numbers came around, I knew I wanted to be at the back of the draft. So when I was able to pick a 10, I was very happy with that because I targeted Chubb relentlessly. Downside, he missed some time, but in the weeks that he's played, he's been phenomenal for me. But so like that was like the one guy that I was like truly targeting. I think the difference for me this time as opposed to in past years and in contrast to other guys is I, for the most part, sat on quarterback for a while. I think I took Rodgers in like the 7th round or, okay, you know, something along those lines. But
6th round.
6th round, yeah.
Yeah.
You know, so for me, first pick in the 6th round. For me and for our league, being 2 quarterbacks, that's late. That's late to take your first quarterback.
It's a complete steal.
So
for a top 6 guy probably season.
Right. So I was looking at it as I wanted to fill in my skill positions, mainly wide receiver. I kind of went with the George method from a few years ago where load up on top wide receivers and then especially with that being a half point PPR, those guys will rack up catches. And it worked out for me with Keenan and Julio when he was healthy. And, you know,
you really lucked out with Keenan Allen and Will Fuller too, though. Just like absolutely popping off both of them. I think,
I wouldn't say lucked out. I think Keenan Allen was viewed as he's still viewed as a top tier guy, but it was a new quarterback. They didn't know what he would be like with Herbert or, Taylor, but I think the biggest thing was Odell in the 4th. I mean, you lost him after week 5, I think. So luckily, Will Fuller kind of filled that for you. Then Will Fuller gets suspended. So you had to, you know, and then Julio was hurt around that time too. So you did have to pivot a lot too. So like, what trades or what pickups do you think helped you throughout the season?
I think the biggest one for me was probably Ayuk. I mean, I knew he was going to have some pretty decent production with Samuel being out early on in the season, but I wasn't sure if that was going to carry over when Samuel came back, and it actually turned out that it got even better with Samuel in there. And then when Kittle got hurt too, I was like, well, those targets got to go somewhere, and thankfully they went to Ayuk. But I mean, another huge pickup for me. So this year was, you know, for a while, J.D. McKissic. You know, I picked him up last second walking into a walking into Hannaford's to do grocery shopping. Texted you. I'm like, shit, James White's out again. Yep, emergency pickup. Yep. And hey, he won me that matchup that week, and he won me a few more since. So I think that those two players, especially Ayuk with the wide receiver injuries that I've been dealing with, I think those helped a lot.
Dickie, were there any big pickups or a big trade?
Oh yeah.
I know you traded for Galladay. That was.
Yeah.
You traded
weak, you idiot, Tully.
You traded Drake for Galladay. Well,
so that was actually a pickup. So I actually had to look back at it because I was like, huh. But I knew I had some pretty key shit that happened. I mean, I don't know. I feel like I took after Tom Penny. Why did I say his last name? I don't know why I said that.
It's okay. Tom. Yeah.
Fuck you, Tom. But I like always see him make so many moves, and I'm like, yeah. So I don't know. I really adopted that, and just being really like agile and keeping that, you know, bench open and just fucking making a ton of moves, going crazy. So I don't know. I think the biggest ones that I had was T. Higgins. That was really huge in the beginning of the year. I got him like pretty quick, and then Travis Fulghams. He was huge for me for a few weeks. Like he won me some matchups. Actually, I think he won me like one of those, you know, baldy special matchups where, you know, I only scored like 120 points and stuff like that. The other guy scored 100.
The baldy special of the week.
And yeah, he really helped me out. And then, yeah, again, I was able to then take him and then I was able to ship him off with, actually that was a different trade. But yeah, I was able to, you know, pick those guys up. I don't know. I definitely cycled through a bunch of players and was kind of working through that. But I mean, realistically, I guess I can't. My number one person has to been Hurts. I definitely had to battle through a bunch of a few pretty key injuries, like with Burrows and
yep. Then you guys. Daniel Jones picked up. You got hurt.
Yep.
Yeah, yep. I mean, and for Hurts, it was great for you because you were kind of. You were clinched first or second seed regardless. So at that point you're like, hey, like I want a quarterback. And I even say, you know, it's kind of risk and Hurts. We don't know. You did it anyways. Right. And it pays well, off, man. And he's got to face Dallas this week. So, which is to my next point, the matchup. Dickie has Mahomes and Hurts. Tully has Rodgers and Ryan. I mean, both pretty good. I think I lean Dickie just because of Mahomes. But
would you start Locke over Ryan, Tull?
Probably not. Not looking at the matchup because with Atlanta playing KC, that game's got to be a shootout. Ryan's got to put the ball up a ton.
But I feel like I heard today that's like Atlanta sucks from coming from behind too. Like. Matty Ice just like
he, but the things like Matty Ice had 27 points last week. Look like they could be up again. They're always up. They always lose. I mean, you've seen Locke at 35 points. You've seen Locke at 2. So like at least Ryan's at safe like 17-24
yeah.
range thing.
Right, and that's the thing. Like, yeah, as much as I want to roll the dice and go with the better matchup on paper, I get like. Because I can't take that risk of Locke putting up a three-pointer and, you know, and being that far behind your team. I mean, your team is solid. It is. I have to score points, so I got to go with the safer plays that are going to put up definitive 15-plus points there.
Yeah. Receivers, Dickie has A.J. Brown, Terry McLaurin, T. Higgins. Tully has Keenan Allen. Emmanuel Sanders, Ayuk. I think it's pretty even. I mean, I'm not a big T. Higgins guy without Burrow.
Yes.
And Ayuk has been fantastic without Debo. Yeah, it's fine. Emmanuel without MT and facing Minnesota could have a great game. Hopefully Keenan Allen, you know, he played last week but not really. So hopefully he's got a like – hopefully he's just
hopefully healthy. All those snaps that he sat out.
and I mean, Dick is at AJ Brown. That's great. He got Terry McLaurin with Dwayne Haskins, who just went to a strip club illegally. So he's probably not going to play. So Alex Smith might be back. So it's good for Terry, I think.
Yep.
But I think it's even. I do lean Tully mainly because of the T. Higgins. I just think T. Higgins is an unstartable guy right now. You have to start him. But he's he's a guy you don't want to start.
And Emmanuel Sanders, dude.
Yeah, but there's no MT. Like, I'd rather Sanders than Higgins. And Terry has
McLaurin over Allen.
Yeah, I don't know. I mean, it depends who the quarterback is that week.
Fuck you guys. McLaurin's going to go, oof! Hey, Scotty, can you beer me for all that stupid shit?
Sure. I'm just going to set it up to you.
Yeah.
I mean, I know how this works, so.
Yeah, just you got to put it right up to the – wait, I can't. Yeah.
Oh, is it?
Yeah, you got to put it right up to the camera. Like, yeah, there you go. Yeah, keep going. Yeah, okay. Thanks. Like, thanks. Oh. Thanks, man. Good shit.
So, as for running backs, Dickie is Swift and Jacobs. Tully is David Johnson and Nick Chubb. And I think David Johnson was a great pickup by you, Tully, I think, 2 weeks ago.
Yeah, just before he was coming off IR. I was like, you know what? If he plays, if he plays, he plays. If he doesn't, you know.
Yeah, so he was a big sit of mine last week, and I was a hit on the run side. I don't know if he's going to catch 12 passes for 109 yards. Like, he's involved in the passing game. So, I mean, with Nick Chubb playing this well and Josh Jacobs being a question mark the last couple weeks, I don't know. It's very close for the RBs.
Yeah.
Cause I do look like I love Swift. I love Chubb. I like David Johnson. Like, it depends what David Johnson we get this week, and same with Josh Jacobs too.
On paper, I could probably go to Tull just because David Johnson.
Yeah.
He's a sucker too. I fucking tried to pick him up, but I think you beat me up for priority.
Tight end, Travis Kelce, Dickie. So Dickie gets that.
I would say, yeah, that's not even. You skip right over tight end.
I mean, Hunter Henry's been a fine play the last few weeks. Flex, Jonathan Taylor or Melvin Gordon. Gotta give it to Jonathan Taylor.
Yep.
Melvin Gordon's been, if Gordon gets a touchdown, it's great. That's fine. But JTT is the better play. And Dickie has Antonio Gibson, who I don't know if he's going to play this week.
I don't think so. I just
and then Tully has Julio, who is also question mark. So your flexes could change completely.
Well, I'll tell you right now. Yeah. I'll do Henderson as my flex. And if for some god reason that Galladay starts, going right in for Higgins, and you're fucked, Tully.
I don't know, man. You know,
he's got McKissick.
They're saying they may need to protect Galladay from himself. You know.
Yeah, they should.
I mean, in reality, they're not making playoffs. There's zero point to put the guy out there.
No point.
All right.
And if something does happen with Julio, like, I'm comfortable this week if something happens with Julio, because as long as Ronald Jones is still out, I feel comfortable sliding Fournette in there to get those two short yardage touchdowns and then catch six balls out of the backfield like he did this past week. Like, I'm secure in that.
Yeah,
I don't want to count on it if I have Julio available in a shootout game like that. But I don't feel as bad if Julio has to sit this week as I did last week.
All right. So that's the matchup. I mean, I'm not gonna say who's I think is gonna win, because I think everyone's also gonna give you that opinion. I think people are gonna say Dickie's gonna win, but they hate Dickie, so they want to. Chris to win. I've heard a few of those things, but my last.
You blame me because I'm the best.
You hate him because he ain't me.
Hey, you got the underdog story over here. You know, last place 4 years in a row. People love a comeback story, Dick. People love a comeback story.
They do. I mean,
well, yeah, really. Okay, look at what I just got an alert on that Josh Gordon just had a setback.
Dickie, don't pick him up.
I might. He literally is not coming back.
Yeah, I know. I saw that. But, like, okay. It doesn't matter, because he's not startable for the last 8 years, so.
Can I pick him up?
Yeah, sure. Yeah, play him too.
Where is he?
So, I'm now the Tully.
Oh, that's right.
What advice? What advice as two former Tullys can you guys give me?
Don't get comfortable at the draft. Stay close to the cooler, man.
Yeah, I would say. I'd say embrace the shit, pretty much.
Yep.
Embrace it, you know.
Yeah, you got it. You have to embrace the hate, embrace the abuse. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And you know, I mean, it could last forever, but it could not. You know what I mean? You could just be back to winning next year, or you could be like Tom and almost get it 2 years in a row. You know.
Or like me, who got it 4 years in a row. Like.
Right. Yeah, I mean, I hope I'm back next year. I mean, no keeper, so we should be good.
Boo!
All right. That's about it. Do you guys have anything else to say before we sign off for the 2020 season?
I've got a question. Do we know where George is?
No.
Yeah, have we done a wellness check?
No. My work does it every week, but I haven't done it for him yet. I'll text him.
Okay.
I'll call him.
Yeah. All right. Well, I mean,
we should probably hear his voice.
Yeah, that's true. So, Tully, I mean, hey, man, with our weekly matchup, you know, may the best man win. Whoever puts out the best score this week, you know?
Hey, you know, sometimes I'm just saying, Dick, if I do beat you, don't get butt hurt.
I won't, because I know I put the lineup out there, and you know,
it's an effect that I have on people that, you know, after an experience with me, they're a little sore in the anal region.
Oh, God. your hair is going deeper.
Well, Dickie's got a few of them for you to play with.
Yeah. Yeah. And if you haven't pointed out yet, the Pine Acres thing was amazing.
Yeah. Oh, so yeah. This is the place that is probably a hot spot for COVID-19, I had to guess.
Oh, COVID-19, HIV, anything that's an acronym, it's sitting there.
The heads. Yep. Yeah, so we'll be back there for, will this be a fifth year in a row next year?
Fifth.
Yep.
I think it's fifth, yeah. That's great. I mean, cheap camping, yeah. I mean, if you guys want to take your family to a cheap place, but very nice, very secure, cute, quaint place, do not go to Pine Acres.
If you do. Anywhere but.
Anywhere but. Go to the Motel 6 down the street. It's way better.
Yeah, awesome.
All right, well, there you have it. These are the two finalists, and I know there's games on Friday, there's games on Saturday, Sunday, Monday, so we might have a full 4 days worth of shit.
Yeah.
So, you know, stay tuned. Guys, well deserved. You guys worked your ass off to get here. So, congrats and may the best man win.
Thank you, Scotty.
Thank you, Scotty. Thank you, sir.
Piece of shit.
All right.
Dickie, good luck.
You too, buddy. Cheers.
All right. Later.